So, good afternoon, everyone. Very much welcome to the next TwoToken webinar. We really hope to enlighten you today again about what tokenization and what the next generation of finance is going to bring you. My name is Don Ginsel, founder of Holland FinTech, and of course very much engaged with this topic as digital finance is going to change the world as we've seen all around us. But I'm not here alone. We have some really great guests. So I'd really like to, of course, get our second host at the table, Alex Bouws and Marleen Everts. Very much welcome. Glad to have you at the table again. And we're very much looking forward to your conversation with all of us a bit later on. But first of all, of course, this is not just about speakers here today. We'd really like to know a little bit more about you at home as well. So we'd like to ask you to fill in a small poll to know exactly who you are, and so we could actually also figure out what your interests are and address the topics accordingly. We also like to know this because we'd like to learn on the follow-on webinars exactly how to address you and which topic might be interesting for you. So we're looking forward to see that. We see a lot of retail investors. And I think we've got quite some answers. So just a few moments for everyone to log on and respond. Yeah, still so quite some answers coming in. Thank you for that. And let's see who we got. So here you have at home as well the results of the poll, and you see that we've got quite a diverse population with quite some investors, but also regulators at the tables, and then quite some ventures as well that are looking for funding. So I'm really happy with this diverse group, and I think that's really interesting as well that we've got such a broad interest for the things that we're doing here. So let's close this, and let's indeed go to our guests at the table. So Marleen and Alex, we're really looking forward to hear a little bit more about the initiative to TwoTokens and what we're going to learn more about today. Alex, can I give you the word first?
Well, thank you, Don. Good to see you again. So this is the fourth masterclass,
It's the fourth already.
Oh, yeah. So we've had a good summer. I'm very happy that we are doing this item today for TwoTokens because investor readiness and tokenization go hand in hand. I'd also like to take this opportunity to thank everybody who's working all these webinars. Don, yourself, Holland FinTech. There's a lot of people, you know, putting a lot of time and effort in TwoTokens and in the masterclasses. And we set up this whole initiative to educate the people on tokenization and how token finance can help the startups and the world. You know, there's a lot of misconceptions about tokenization. People were a little bit afraid of crypto, and so that's the whole purpose of TwoTokens. To that end, you know, from the project that we started a year ago, we now also started a foundation with an executive board, to which will every year do experiments and do use cases where tokens and token finance is used. And the whole community in TwoTokens is made up of lawyers, investors, financiers, fintech like yourself, and we're all working on these use cases, such as NextGen Capital. And as it so happens, some of these use cases become real viable enterprises.
Yeah. Right? But so the primary goal is first to educate everyone about what this technology can do. Right?
Yes. Yeah. Not only educate, but also make sure that everybody starts talking the same lingua franca, starts talking from the same page. You know? But there's a lot of confusion. And what helps is that in the world, the Netherlands and TwoTokens in particular are working with the ITSA, which is an International Token Standardization Association. Yeah. And so we look at what kind of token, what is the economic purpose of the token, and that is what the ITSA are working on. And on the other hand, we are working with the IWA, which is an international working alliance with large companies like ING Bank, IBM, you know. And we work on standardizing token solutions, which are going to be used, you know, in electronic bills of lading and supply chains and capital, all types of solutions.
And actually, the next masterclass, the ITSA, is actually going to be present here well.
So that's really interesting to
share
hear about
a bit
as well.
More on their views.
Yeah. So the fun part about TwoTokens is that on the one hand, it's a lot of legal regulatory technology. right? Especially what needs to be done from the law and from. But there's a lot of technology that's involved, decentralized technology, DLT, what have you, and bringing those together is that's what we do here. And I think what's also interesting, and I think we can mention it here at the table, you know, you're the first to hear, is that we will have a summit, which will present all the results of the three use cases that we've been working on, and the use case that we're doing on central bank digital currency. And that summit will be held in conjunction with Rabobank mid-October. You know, and you should all log on. It will, because of COVID-19, it will have to be an online event.
Okay, but that's basically the moment when a much larger public could actually learn about everything that's happening at 2Token at the moment. Right?
Yes. Okay. You're all invited to partner up and to become a member, and all of the content, all these webinars, you know, this is live, of course, but you can go to the website 2tokens.org or Next Generation Capital, where all these webinars, all this content is distributed.
Yeah, all right. Well, I think that's really interesting. So thank you for explaining that. And I think it's nice that you pick up on some of those really practical economical cases where we just see that their technology could make a really big impact, but we just don't have all the stakeholders at the table just yet, or at least we didn't have it before, to actually start solving these cases. So I think it's really a sound contribution that we're making here.
Yes.
So thanks for that explanation. Before we go to you, Marleen, I'd like to just ask a next poll. To just understand a little bit about how the audience thinks about this. Do you feel that there's enough qualitative, sustainable investment opportunities within the Netherlands? So we're really curious to learn more about your opinion here. So please reach out and let us know about your opinion about this. We'll just give it a minute for you to fill it in.
Yeah, so one of the subjects of today is, of course, how tokenization might help, you know, early stage companies, right?
Yeah, so I think what is special of today is what we're actually going to discuss here today is the next generation capital use case. I'm Marleen Everts. I'm one of the advisory board members of 2Tokens, and therefore also leading the next generation capital use case. But in my profession, in my working life, I'm the CEO and co-founder of NExchange, which is a fully regulated exchange.
Yep.
Next generation capital is a use case where we collaborate with almost the whole Dutch ecosystem on developing a new financial structure to accelerate and promote sustainable finance. It's a 2Tokens use case. It's been selected as a real-life use case that we are implementing right now. And in that context, in that matter, we are organizing these masterclasses. So it's a substream of 2Tokens. The project is called Next Generation Capital.
Yep.
And this, in fact, is our fourth masterclass. The topic of today will be investor readiness. And with investor readiness, we mean how fit is this proposition for the investment market. Not only for retail investors, but especially for also the institutional investors and the professional investors. Because the whole sustainability as a topic is so important for our generation, for our children's generation. And the financial sector is going to be an intersection in terms of capital distribution towards investments that need to be made in sustainability. This requires a huge amount of money, and we need to make sure that we have a framework or structure where also the larger capital can invest in.
Yeah, should we just briefly look at that poll as well, because then we actually see how important our audience thinks that is. So we see that quite a lot of people find it hard to find qualitative suitable investment opportunities. So that's definitely something I think that you're trying to tackle also with this initiative. And the Netherlands is not active enough to actually support ventures that are working in this area. So I think that's already sort of the major conclusions that we could take now from this initial poll, which I think resonates with why you were starting this initiative, if I'm correct.
Yes, and it's strange because, in fact, there is a lot of development going on in the Netherlands, but the worrisome thing is that it's not funded in the Netherlands, and it either disappears or it doesn't succeed for the mere fact that we cannot find the right funding channels to fund these initiatives. Working together with these groups, we've built and created this new financial structure. And it is set up for the mere reason that financing sustainability brings it into a couple of challenges. The main challenge is that it mostly involves new technology development. New technology development of technology that's never been there before, for obvious reason, otherwise we wouldn't be in this situation.
Yep.
And it mostly involves also new ventures. And the combination of those two makes it almost impossible for the institutional or the professional investors to invest in, purely because it doesn't fit their mandate, their risk profiles. And for that we've created this new structure. And the structure is what we call the next generation capital vertical. And, mm-hmm. and for that, maybe we can switch on to the next slide,
yes.
where there's a very simplified overview of what this next generation capital vertical is about. It actually is a virtual basket. It concerns a virtual basket of multiple ventures. Mm-hmm. And it's offered as one investment opportunity to the market. So by investing into this vertical, your investment, whether you are an institutional or whether you are a retail investor,
yep.
equally gets distributed over multiple ventures, which means that you get a distribution over all these ventures. It's thematic. The theme is absolutely sustainability.
Yep.
But in the deep tech development.
Because that's quite popular these days as well, right? To actually pick a specific theme you want to invest in. So I think you're really playing into a good trend there as well, to make it easy for people to pick a pool
yes.
of topics that they relate to.
Yes, and we pick deep tech because deep tech investment on its own is already a challenge on its own. It's a long investment cycle before these deep tech ventures actually come to a situation where they become they make revenue or even create profit. But once they are there, then it becomes an interesting area. But it is needed for our sustainability. And actually, in the Netherlands, we have a couple of very very good universities that are very active in this whole deep tech development. And within our vertical structure, we have a concept which is called the program manager,
yep.
Which is key to the program, which is key to the vertical. This program manager has a lot of characteristics of what a normal fund manager would have in a VC fund or a typical investment fund, but it goes a lot deeper than that. It operates the program manager itself operates very closely to the ventures. It's involved in selecting technology and selecting talented teams,
yep.
From the right institutions, from the right companies all over the world. And these program managers, they actually have a whole ecosystem around them. And today we actually have HiTech Excel on the table.
Yep.
Guus Frerichs will be here after us. And he will explain how HiTech Excel, which is the venture builder of Philips and ASML, how they are set up, how their ecosystem is structured, for them to be able to really evaluate this technology and to make sure that these ventures actually make it to a successful business. And what is needed to set that up. So that yep. is...
They're closely tied into the university as well, right?
They're so very closely tied to Eindhoven University. Our other program manager is Jess Delft, which
yep.
is obviously tied to Delft University. So two of our most prominent universities. And then in that case, if it's up to us, the best venture builders and accelerator programs are now involved in this new finance structure closely involved and really opening up their ecosystems to the investors. And for the investors to be able to tie into that and join what they are actually doing there in Eindhoven on the Philips campus, which is a magnificent place.
Yeah, that's a really cool place. So I think one of the challenges might be that, let's say, of course, they're in there so with a dual role. So they're once they're helping to build the ventures, but they're also acting on behalf of the investors. How do they do that?
Yes, in the case of HiTech Excel, they are even, because they are venture builders, they are also shareholders of these ventures, partially shareholders of the, these ventures, and they are inviting investors to join and invest in these ventures on behalf of their investment mandate. So HiTech Excel develops, builds 30 ventures, all with a deep tech character in the area of sustainability. There's a distribution of a clean tech, med tech. It's a basket of ventures. And each of these ventures will get a certain amount of money allocated for them. And this amount of money, in the case of HiTech Excel, would be 1.2 million per venture to make it up until the Series A investment round.
Okay.
And these ventures will not get this bucket of money from the start. They will get it once they reach certain milestones in their development. And HiTech Excel, with their ecosystem, is the leading decision maker and saying, okay, this venture has really reached that milestone. Yep. We can allocate a next bucket of money, and then automatically an exchange or the exchange will then allocate funds to these ventures, and the investors will receive shares in return.
Okay. And do the investors need to commit that money? They need to commit it, of course, at the beginning. But do they have to make it available directly, or is it called on basically based on these milestones?
It depends whether you are an institutional investor or a retail investor. In terms of retail investors, they already allocate and it is reserved. So the funds, the money up for the first three rounds is reserved on a trust account, and gets settled once these ventures make these milestones. And in case of institutional investors, it will be called once the venture reaches that next milestone.
Yep.
And that makes it just from out of a practical reason, of course. What happens if these ventures don't reach that milestone within the set time frame? Then the funds go back to the investor. Then it's just released again. The commitment is also released, and the investor doesn't need to make that follow-up investment.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, I think it's a really clear story. I think it's great that you're able to enable this technology and this movement and hopefully a new generation of venture funding indeed. So
yes. So I'm curious, and today, so HiTech Excel and Guus Gerichs from HiTech Excel will be sitting here. Yep. They have just been nominated as one of the five most successful venture builders in the world, alongside of Y Combinator, 500 startups. It's crazy
it's really amazing.
Actually have this going on in the Netherlands.
Yep.
And also Meijner Jansma from Container Investments, who is so knowledgeable in this area, will be sharing his views on what kind of challenges we run as investors and how this vertical will address the problems and the challenges that we're bumping into when we need to invest in this area.
Yep. So yeah, I think that's great. It's a great example of how large the ecosystem is actually around these solutions. So really looking at it from all angles and involving all the stakeholders.
Yes.
So I'm really curious. Maybe we should get Guus and Meijner at the table.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think before we get started to Guus and Meijner, we actually have one last poll question where we are very interested to see what the opinion of the public is about. So. Or am I making a mistake? I'm making a mistake.
No, I made a mistake earlier. No. The poll has already been done that was planned for now. So we already know indeed what the audience thinks about sustainable investing. So thank you, both of you, Alex and Marleen, for telling us a bit about what Two Tokens has to offer. We're very looking forward to have Meijner and Guus at the table. Meijner, very much welcome.
Hi.
Good to see you. thanks for joining us today. You've got, of course, quite a good background in investing in technology startups. So really curious to learn a bit more about how you see the market and especially how you feel that this new solution of next-gen capital might contribute to solving actually some of the challenges that ventures have with early-stage funding.
Thank you, Dan.
Can you maybe first introduce yourself a little bit?
Meinert Jansberg, Catena Investments, investment firm based in Amsterdam, active in sustainable energy. Worked a lot with the accelerators mentioned before by Marleen. And quite a lot of experience in funding the different stages of startups. And from that experience, we saw the last years that there is a good cooperation between universities, businesses, and science universities. Within this, we call it a triple helix discussion, but within that discussion, we often see the lack of capital. Recent years, we've seen a lot of regional development funds that came to the market to fill in this gap. Mm-hmm. But that is still not sufficient enough. And one of the main reasons we see is that deal sizes are relatively small. They are spread throughout the country. These regional development goals have very strict terms. They're not allowed to invest in other regions, for example. They have a local focus. So we still see a lack of capital. And a very different, that's very difficult to get capital allocated to ventures. Furthermore, we see from the investor perspective that deals are spread out. Risk appetite is often different from the return. A lot of risks involved.
Yep.
It's difficult to manage. So it's not only return on investment; it's also return on effort, which is an issue.
Yep.
It's very difficult to get this capital to the ventures, and therefore the initiative of Two Tokens, which is going on right now, is a very good one. Especially if we look to the to the Valley of Death, we see the picture over here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Most startups are able to fund themselves through the first phase via accelerators, subsidies, etc.
Yep.
But it's very, very difficult to get to the next stage. There is not a general database or a phone number you can call and get help to get the next funding. You need to do it all yourself.
And is it basically between, let's say, informal investors and more formal venture capital? Is that where the gap is?
Yeah, there is a gap. So we see a venture capital gap, where the development phase is often done by private money with private loans, by friends,
subsidies,
etc., grants, etc. And then you need to scale up, you need to invest, you have to build your prototypes, you need to invest, and then it gets difficult.
Yeah.
And we see a venture capital gap over there, which is hard to fill in. The regional development funds try to fill it in. They, as said before, they have pretty strict terms. And then it's even very difficult for private capital to meet these terms of the regional development goals. Mm. So if you want to build up a spread portfolio, that's really hard as an investor.
Yeah. Do you see that the venture builders, like we're going to hear from Guse in a moment, but do you feel that they can play an important role also to bridge that gap between the informal side of investment and the more formal side?
Yeah.
Because, of course, it is a process that you could get better at.
Yeah, because if you look to an investor, to do an investment, you need to see a lot of deals. So if you want to select a few deals and you want to build up a spread portfolio, you need to see almost the whole Dutch landscape.
Yeah.
And if a party is involved like a venture builder, that process improves the return on effort very much.
Okay.
Yeah. So that would be very a very good idea and very helpful. And especially in bridging the gap between these phases of the valleys of death startups are challenged with.
Yeah.
So we think this vertical financing idea has the big advantage for investors that they get access to a broad portfolio of investments instead of selecting themselves.
Mm-hmm.
having their own discussions within their own investment committees, etc. It takes very much time for a very little investment. It's team-based, so you can pretty good, you can select it pretty good. What do I want, what not? It's a regulated marketplace, which is an advantage because it means that I can not only sell my investment in the fund, but also in the target companies.
You have a secondary trading option, which is definitely important, I think, and something that you very often don't have with alternative ways of investing in ventures.
So that's very helpful. It's good for your allocation as an investor, and if second rounds or third rounds are up, you're of course at the table. So the initiative is highly interesting because it solves a few issues currently in the market, and that is the bridge between the different phases of funding and the effort it takes to select the right investments as a as an investor.
Yeah, it's also interesting, I think, that it's a hybrid model where you have both professional investors as retail investors that could join forces and actually so you get much smarter and you have more capital at your availability.
Yeah, that's true, and that is an advantage, especially if there is a bit of liquidity in this market. It could attract much more capital, and that is simply necessary.
Yeah, I'm also very curious to see if we could actually see this rolled out across other verticals, because we've got, of course, now deep tech and sustainability as focus, but ideally, of course, we see this happening across all the venture verticals that you can imagine. So really, really interesting, I think, to hear your perspective here. And so is there anything particular that you're also curious to see in the next steps that are going to develop?
Yeah, well, I'm very curious if we will be able to launch this vertical. I think there are very good chances of doing so at the moment. And then the proof is in the first investments. That will be very important. And if that succeeds, I think a lot of investors, it's like a sheep over the dam, as we say it here in Holland.
Yeah.
I think if the proof is there, that a lot of other investors will follow as well.
Yeah.
So it's highly important to get this started. There have been a lot of initiatives in the past to solve this issue. It hasn't worked out so far, so this should work.
Yeah, no, I think it's definitely good. But it's nice already to see that we've got so many stakeholders at the table. So I'd like to hear also from you, Guus. Guus Frerix, very much welcome at the table as well from HiTech Excel. Can you please give a brief introduction about yourself?
About myself. I'm a tech guy. All my working life I've been involved in advanced technologies, enabling technologies. I love technology. Maybe it has to do with being a kid of Philips parents. So my mother worked for Philips in R&D for 30 years, my father for 42 years in finance and accounting. So I think at a very young age, I got fascinated by technology, innovation, entrepreneurship, and I'm a big believer that addressing the grand challenges societies are facing today, if you combine innovation, technology, and entrepreneurship, you can make significant impact. I built business, I sold business, I'm an entrepreneur. I've built my own semiconductor company, and a few years ago sold that to a big industry giant in the US. With the money I got, I'm reinvesting that myself, so I'm playing with my own money. I'm the founder of HiTech Excel, and maybe a little bit about HiTech Excel, I think that's more important than talking about myself. What we aim to do is, we started in 2012. And back in the days, there were a lot of accelerators all popping up all over the place, also in the US, Y Combinator, TechStarts, etc. But they were primarily focusing on what I call web and app kind of business, finding the new Facebook,
short cycles.
The next Facebook, Twitter, this, that, and so on. And that makes sense because that's short cycles, but also fairly limited money involved in the early stage. And I discovered there was nothing really focused on deep tech, on advanced technologies, on hardware. So it's like, there must be something. Eindhoven has unique knowledge in deep tech domain. With of course the mothership being Philips, but you know, out of Philips a lot of spin-outs, ASML, it's a spin-out of Philips a few decades ago. Now I wish around that time I would have invested in that startup. Imagine what would be your return by now. And that region has unique skills in high precision engineering, mechatronics, embedded software, system design. That is basically the skills which glue NXP, semiconductors, ASML, Philips, VDL, etc., etc. It is, yeah. And then we have the high-tech campus where over 160 companies are located, 12,000 researchers, 80 nationalities. Yeah. So yeah, that's just a big pool of young Einsteins, I would say. Incredibly bright. And, you know, building, I was like, you know, there must be a way to mobilize that unique knowledge, skills and networks and help young tech startups. That is how we started. We have built by now a portfolio of over 70 companies, 2/3 still alive. The basket of 5x return on investment is between 15% and 20% consistently. So with that, I think we're doing significantly better than market average in the early stage. Average in Europe, AEF-backed early stage VCs have around 4% of their portfolio in the bucket above 5x. So we're doing pretty well. And then we moved away from Startup Accelerator and said, you know, what if we're gonna build companies from the ground up? So together with our partners, so for instance, ASML, we went to CERN in Switzerland. You know, I guess you know CERN, eh, where they're researching the gold particle.
The particle accelerator.
Yeah. And we were there like, you know, I feel like a kid in the candy store, by the way. If I'm there and I see all these technologies, I go crazy. And together with folks from Strategic New Business Development of ASML, R&D ASML, Philips, our team, we were assessing technologies, and we were looking for those technologies where, you know, we have a lot of unique knowledge and skills. Technologies which have great disruptive potential, but also that we can pick them up because we have a lot of knowledge. So one thing, cooling, an advanced cooling solution we took, and that cooling solution is used to cool the detectors in the accelerator.
Okay. Yeah.
That's in the ground, and CERN figured out a way to do cooling in a brilliant way. And it's running for 6 years. So we were like, hey, that solution that could be interesting. We could maybe do something with this cooling in the ASML machines, but also in other areas. And a laser technology, which is super advanced, where we believe that we can, we now have a venture which is testing actually their product next week. If you go from 4 to 5G, a lot of new towers need to be built because the signal goes higher frequency, but it travels shorter distance. Yep. So new towers.
Can I ask you something about that?
Yeah, you need to.
No, because I think it's really interesting. But one thing that, for example, triggers with me is, for example, how do you look at intellectual property around this? Because that's for investors sometimes quite a hot topic.
Yeah.
And some would always say, you know, without patents, I'm not going anywhere.
Yeah.
And others are more towards a more licensing model.
Yeah.
Do you have a specific strategy for that?
Yeah, we have a specific strategy. Maybe it's part of the tool. So I see if we can go one slide back for the audience. So basically, you know, in high tech, it's difficult. Long cycles, you need to absolutely know what you are doing.
Yep.
And in order to build ventures in a structured way, we really put a lot of effort in structuring it. So what you see on the slide on the left-hand side is 7 KPI areas, more classical one as business model, but also there's technology and IPR.
Yep.
So that is a KPI area. So, and for all these KPI areas, we have broken that down, and that is in the middle of the slide. We have made a maturity index because, startups, we talk about startups where they are still pre-revenue. And then when there is revenue, we call it a scale up. And then when it's really growing, we call it mature business. Well, there's much more to it, of course.
Yep.
So what we have built is a maturity index. We have 5 startup levels, 3 scale up levels, and then the highest in the top is maturity, mature business. And then linked to these stages, all these KPIs we have broken down. IPR is an important element. There must be, especially in tech companies, you need to have IP.
Yeah.
How you do it? There are different ways. It could be building your own patent portfolio. We have a venture now which is using patented technology by Philips Research. So that has been developed by Philips for 7 years. And now this startup is going to run with it. And they've got an exclusive
license.
Worldwide irrevocable license. And then still we advise them to, on top of that IP, build their own IP portfolio. So we have a very, very structured approach. And if you go to the next slide, this is how it then works. So we have a 9-month program. So we source the technologies with our partners and we assess that before we even start.
Yep.
So if there is something wrong with IP or IP infringement or it is too difficult, we just not even bother to get going with it. So we only start ventures on the basis of technologies which have been properly assessed. That's number one. Number two, we do super, super intense screening on potential co-founders.
Okay.
So we screen talent really, really, really in depth. And then in phase one we start. So basically we have assembled a team which is relevant for that technology and that domain with the right now this, that and so on. Good technology, and then we get going. And we have 3 times 3 months, and it's super intense. So here you see, close to 60 deliverables in 3 months. That's week by week. It's going to be assessed by the entrepreneurs in residence. These are seasoned, experienced, and tech entrepreneurs, been there, done it, scars are still healing. And every week, these teams are monitored on not only are they executing speed of execution, but also quality of deliverables. And it's very tough, I must say. And yeah, if I look back, 2/3 are not going to make it. So and that's okay for us. So if we start with a cohort of 10 new ventures, because of the strictness of the program, we expect maybe 2-3 to end the finish line.
Okay.
Now, the interesting point linked to the subject of today, investor readiness, is that we involve our experts. So the KPI areas I spoke about, so maybe the KPI area product and underlying technology platform. Then we involve the super smart people from ASML. So there is this company who is building a cooling solution, and we believe that we can significantly boost the output power of data center by directly cooling the CPUs in the server racks. And then ASML folks have helped this company, it's called InCooling, a great lot to validate that technology. And then with ASML, they can make the difference.
Yep.
But then ASML ticks off, hey, this technology can work. This should be the product roadmap. Yes, indeed. And that is what you see in this slide, accreditation. So after every 3 months, there is an in-depth screening of the progress. And then, there comes an independent accreditation report, which is completely automated tool chain we have on the basis of the assessment of the industry experts. And that is then triggering an investment round, because what Meindert said is earlier on is very true. We see a lot of investors being scared about high tech. And I can understand that. If you don't have the technology knowledge or the network or the industry expertise, is very difficult to assess what can fly and what is not going to fly.
Yeah, I think it's really very often you see the difference between building technology and bringing technology to the market are two completely different skills.
Yeah.
And very often they're not united in a venture.
Exactly.
And it's hard to assess. But I think you've built the ecosystem to actually facilitate exactly that.
Yeah, and I think that makes a difference. And if you ask me what is the reason why we have substantially higher success rates than if we compare with early stage VCs in multiples, I think it has to do with, I guess we figured out how to successfully connect the giants with the new companies.
Yeah.
And I see without exception, for instance, in supply chain, how to build a scalable sustainable supply chain with a global reach. Mm-hmm. A lot of startups in the high-tech domain make mistakes there. They think that if they have a working prototype and if it can produce 10 of those, they can scale up. Wrong.
Yeah.
And by leveraging the knowledge of these tech giants on these aspects, we by building the companies up from the ground up, we can make sure and check, double check that they don't make the silly mistakes.
This is a big advantage that you're already embedded in a supply chain.
Exactly.
And with a lot of other startups, it's exactly as you say, Guus, that they have a prototype, they define a go-to-market, they try to get customers, and actually your future customer is involved in your in the development of
from day one.
Yeah.
And that's a huge advantage, and actually it's another way of bringing technology and ventures to the market instead of going through the whole more traditional process. So this seems more or less a shortcut, though it's very very intense.
Yeah.
To get a better investment proposition, because as an investor, I need less to worry about IP, market size, deals that already contracted.
No, exactly.
And I get a completely different view on the Excel models, which promise all kinds of hockey stick revenue.
No, exactly. Yeah, promising high returns is not always easy, but making high returns is really hard.
Yeah.
Just one second before, because I think it's really interesting, but I also want to address the viewers here, because you also might have questions that we can address here. So please let us know and type your questions to us, so we're able to pick them up as well. Sorry, go ahead.
Mine that is spot on. Startups in general, and also high-tech startups, often when they talk to investors, they try to sell their company in a rosier way than it actually is, and it's up to the investor to discover to what extent is that true and make the risk-return profile. That takes a lot of time and effort. And what we are doing here in this structured program is, in a way, we're executing due diligence. So, on every single gate, there comes an accreditation report, which not only gives an indication, accredited, again, by independent industry experts, what is the status, but also what is the next challenge to progress in maturity on every KPI area.
Yep. Can we tie that to the stage gate approach as well? It would be interesting to show that again and see how that relate.
Yeah, exactly. So if you do it like that, then you make it fully transparent. You are completely open. You're very strict. Teams which 3 weeks in a row, for instance, come with I couldn't hit my deliverables because my little toe is hurting and my dog is sick and blah blah blah. Then we say, sorry guys, this is probably not for you, and it's definitely not something for us to continue. That is the door, go out.
Yeah.
So if you structure it and if you make very transparent in maturity what is there and what is the next big step, you can couple it to funding cycles, gated funding. So we're also not asking immediately, to invest everything. You shouldn't do that. If you break it up by and that is what you see, step by step, we go higher in the, it starts with assembling the team, the technology assessment, validating the market proposition, getting customers signed up, co-creation, co-development projects, this, that, and so on. Yeah, and then you can couple that to funding cycles.
Yeah, it makes it really clear also for the ventures what to perform to get to the next milestone.
Absolutely, and that is why I love this whole idea, because in reality, and I think Mindert knows probably even more about this, I observe that these tech startups spend way too much time in chasing the money. And all that, and that's the founder's time. I also, for my own semiconductor company, it took us like 6 quarters to raise $2.5 million here in the Netherlands. I went to pitch the company in New York on an investor event. I asked for $10 million, and the feedback was, hey, how much faster can you go if we give you 20 rather than 10? So you see a lot of this attention of the founder team is the energy is consumed chasing the money.
Yeah, it's true. They need a lot of time to attract funding, And not only attracting the funding, the negotiation process over on how the funds are invested takes a lot of time and effort as well.
Yeah.
I've seen deals in the past where up to 25% of the investment was spent on consultants, lawyers, etc.
Yeah, that's really
it happened in the past.
Yeah. Yeah.
Especially with lower amounts, it happens.
Yeah. And so that is why I love this this initiative, because bigger investors typically say, it is relatively small money, it is a risky asset class, I need to spend a lot of due diligence. Yeah, that's a logical explanation why they are moving up for a little bit later stage, when there's initial revenue.
Yeah, exactly.
And that is what I love about this initiative of putting it in a vertical basket, 30, so we can spread.
You pool resources, right? So indeed, you don't have to make that contract 30 times.
Exactly. So it saves time for the founders. It is fully transparent for the investors. It's gated. There is this extra layer of checks on investor readiness by very respected smart people from the big companies, from the ecosystem.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Chris, is there one defining point which explains the 30% that is successful?
Yeah, I think the crucial element is the ability to, I think a couple of things. It's not one thing. I think there are a few things. One is we immediately have these young ventures and the founding teams tapping into the knowledge base of the big guys. I think that makes a lot of difference. And the other one is, we only work with experienced people. The tech business is, and especially deep tech, enabling technologies, advanced technologies, is a very specific domain, and you just need to have a lot of industry know-how and expertise to turn that into a success. And I think that combination, the community-driven approach, the strength of the ecosystem in Eindhoven, the unique competencies and knowledge, mixed up with a very, very structured approach, almost a scientific approach, I would say, to building ventures. I think that combination and our connection with research center. You need to have good technology. So I spoke about CERN. We also source technologies at TNO. We source technologies at European Space Agency. Of course, the machine itself is running, but the input in terms of quality of talent and quality of technology, to a large extent, determines the output of the process.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting. I'm trying to see if we're getting any questions in, so please all feel free to jump in if you have any questions, but I'm not seeing any at the moment. Maybe just I have one more question. How do you work with together with the university? I think it's a very important source of talent on one hand, but for example, you could also tie it into valorization, right? So indeed, making use of technology that's developed at university.
Mm-hmm.
To what end, how far does that collaboration go?
Yeah, very intensively and on different dimensions, I would say. Number one, sourcing in technologies from the TUE, which are promising. On the other hand, an important feeder of incredibly talented tech people and business innovation people. So we have a lot of graduation students, masters, PhD assignments, this, that, and so. But we also, we try to make it a chain event. We typically pick up projects and technologies where we believe that within 6 to 8 quarters, we should get them in TRL level 7 minimum, which means testing in a relevant environment. Now, and a lot of development is, of course, happening before. So we're also helping the TUE with our knowledge and already at a very early stage, ideation, help these new young entrepreneurs to think about building a business. For instance, today, actually, I'm here, but otherwise I would have been in the jury at the TUE. Today is the census competition, so the TUE is every year hosting international competition where 20 technical universities are participating. Every year they take a certain disease as a starting point and then start to think about diagnosis, tools, how to improve. And what we are doing there is we say, and then the competition ends, and all these bright kids go back to their country again, and we say, hey, for those, not for everybody, this is really a brilliant idea. We should build a venture out of that. So then we give them the opportunity to participate in our program. And
that's really nice. So and, you really and try to spark entrepreneurship there at an early stage.
Yes.
Okay. I think that's really cool. So I'm not getting any questions in. So Meinert, maybe first and last words from your end on this project and how you see the collaboration with HiTech Excel as an investor as well.
Well, as said before, what is interesting is that there is a body or an entity that puts really a lot of effort in the selection process, and that saves a lot of time. It also saves a lot of money, of course, and it improves the returns. So the big advantage of having a party like HiTech Excel involved in these startups is a better output, and that reduces risks. It makes risks more understandable. Often a lot of investments just don't work because the risks aren't understood, and actually you have a sort of advanced partner in front. Who brings in a lot of expertise and knowledge instead of a simple investment manager, which looks at the portfolio, looks at the reports, and says, okay, this KPA has met, so we put in the next money. It's much more intensified, and that is one of the big advantages, and it gives a spreading, so reduces risks, more spread, and that's very important.
Yeah, no, I think so too. I think it's really interesting to really bring in this new concept of venture financing because it indeed has a lot of advantages and complements, I think, the existing structures very well. So thank you both for joining today. I think it's really interesting to learn more about your perspectives on the investor readiness and the way that we can finance ventures here. We have one last poll for our audience. Like to ask you all to fill in the information, or actually it's two polls in a row. So please provide us with your insights into how relevant venture maturity accreditation is and the role of the industry experts in that. We're looking forward to get your insights, whether that's crucial, not so relevant, or irrelevant. Just briefly, so what do you think about this, Meinert?
I think it's very relevant.
Maybe not to probe the answers, but
No, it's very relevant.
Yeah, I think so too.
It helps.
It's indeed. I think it's really sort of how do you make a bridge if you talk about the valley of death, right? Yeah. So how do you get across the valley? Well, they play an important role.
Yeah, it's a very important role, and it's impossible as one investor or investment manager to know everything. So this is embedded in a network, and therefore that's value. That's simply value. So it's very important to have this in place.
Yeah, I think so too. So I think most people agree with this, as I can show you now. So indeed, that's what most people find it crucial, which I would anticipate as well.
That's crucial, but it's not the only thing that's important.
Of course, of course. Yeah, but that's indeed, it's a condition that's really important, but of course there are more things, which I think were also mentioned, like talent, scouting, and such. Then we have a last poll for you. Whether you believe that this concept of vertical financing is interesting to you? Well, I think that's really, we talked about it a lot. It's the fact that you can take a theme and pool the risk of a portfolio of ventures all at once. I think it's quite extraordinary that we're able to provide that kind of solution. So what do you think, Meinert? Is that something that's... because it is relatively new, I would say.
Yeah, it's relatively new. And I hope it will open up a market. I think it's interesting for a lot of investors because you buy in knowledge you normally cannot buy in as an investor. Doesn't mean that you can lean back and just transfer the money and don't look at it anymore, but it makes it much more easier to get into these deep tech investments.
Yeah, I can understand. And so, Guus, do you think it's also interesting to you know, invite investors over to, Marlene already told us it was one of the coolest places to be these days around Eindhoven and where Hightech Excel is based. So are you looking to also basically host investors there to show them
around?
Oh,
yeah, absolutely. And, you know, in the end of the day, it is people-to-people business. And,
yeah.
Me talking about the structure, the approach, the ecosystem, you have to experience it. And it really starts to live when you listen to the pitches of these incredible companies who have survived our program. Then you see, hey, this could be, and that is actually our goal, this could be the next ASML, the BSML, the CSML, the DSML. And, I'm more than happy to show you around. And,
All right. Well, I would definitely like to come. So, and if I look at the poll, then it also looks like a lot of the viewers at the moment are really interested in this concept. So I think you can count on some visitors sometime soon, Guus.
Excellent.
I think it's really cool. Let's wrap it up. Thank you very much for coming, Meindert, Guus, and of course also Marlene and Alex before. So to actually, I think we've got quite a nice view again at how the next generation finance will look like. I'm especially interested. Thank you for your contribution here to give the investor perspective as well as the way that you view how you nourish these companies, scout the best technologies, and turn them into world-class ventures. I think it was really really enthusiasm, I think, raised by that story. So thanks for that. Thank you all at home viewing. I hope you really found this a very interesting webinar again. You'll be able to view it again later should you have missed parts of it. And please also share if you'd like to have other people view this. We're looking forward to host you again at our next webinar of Two Tokens and Next Generation Finance. Thank you very much for viewing.